The title of our lecture tonight is Dreams of Union, Days of Conflict, Communicating Social Justice and Civil Rights, Memory in the Age of Barack Obama. It's going to be fun, isn't it, to see how our speaker pivots from, we all talked for a while about the age of Obama. It's going to be interesting to see now, like, what he makes of that. So good luck to you for that. But as you all know, the Arnold Lecture is really kind of the intellectual high point of the year for our organization. It's where we come together. Last night, we celebrated activism. Tomorrow, we give out awards. But tonight, we celebrate scholarship. We celebrate the best thinkers in our field who produce the best research in our field. And so as soon as I had the opportunity to schedule this lecture, I knew who I wanted. He's the author of a book called The Reconstruction Desegregation Debate, The Politics of Equality and the Rhetoric of Place. And this book won not one, but two major national awards. That doesn't happen very often in our discipline that one book wins two major national awards. Since then, he's been the co-editor of the Sage Handbook of Rhetorical Studies, published in 2009. He's the co-editor of Making the Case, Advocacy and Judgment in Public Argument, published in 2012. He's the author of dozens of articles and book chapters, just an amazing scholar. He is also the president-elect of the Rhetoric Society of America, which shows me that he's a colleague who's dedicated to doing the hard work and the service that nourishes the organizations that make our scholarship possible. So, side note to the NCA Committee on Committees and Nominating Committee, that here's a man who will serve the organization. he's gonna work for them for 6 years, but then we're gonna draft him onto our team. Now, I could go on and on about his amazing academic and scholarly chops, but I did want to confess that the main reason I wanted to invite him to speak to you tonight is because he's a great public speaker. It's become fashionable to look down your nose at public speaking, and none of you tenured professors want to teach public speaking, but it is the essence of who we are. It's where we began. It's what gives us an ethical foundation, and it's what our nation needs so very, very desperately. And I'll tell you that it breaks my heart every year when I come to the NCA and I watch people read papers. And I watch people say, and whatever, and not be able to speak in a complete sentence. And it's important that we, instead of that, model a best communication practice. We need more of those models. We need to see more examples of what that looks like. I don't want to set our speaker up for failure, but he's one of the very, very best. Now, he's one of the best because he begins from texts and objects and people and places, real material things, and he digs into them, and from there he asks the big questions. And after asking the big questions, he then does what not enough of us do, which he asks the noble questions. Questions about love, justice, reconciliation, forgiveness, memory. These are the big questions. Now, if we ask the questions without data, there's no heft there. But what I love about our speaker tonight is he asks the noble questions on the basis of beautiful, detailed textual readings. And I think that's, for me, personally, that's a model of a kind of scholarship that I admire, that I respect. I know he's going to be beautiful tonight. I know he's going to make us feel better about our nation and how we respond to what happened last week. He's going to save your soul. All right. It's going to be a good night, though. It's going to be a very good night. I want you to welcome, please, up to the stage, yet another award-winning professor from Penn State University, my friend, my colleague, one of my heroes, Dr. Kirt Wilson.
You do realize, right, that to save a person's soul takes about an hour and a half. Right? So if we're going to church, we're going to be here a little while. You might as well relax, settle in. I can't
I can't express to you how pleased, how proud, and how honored I am to have this opportunity, and to thank Stephen for that wonderful introduction. You know, earlier today, I was sitting at a table with several of my graduate school friends, individuals that I went to graduate school with, Eric Watts and Robert Terrell, and we were talking just briefly about this particular opportunity, and they said to me, you know, the job really isn't that hard. It isn't that hard. All you gotta do is just heal the nation. But now I've gotta save souls too. I appreciate the kind words about oratory and about presentation, because I'll be honest with you, I think those particular skills do in fact matter. They matter a great deal because the process of communication and its opportunity to kind of intertwine both the mind as well as the heart is still a form of magic. It's still an opportunity for us to embrace what it fundamentally means to be human. And even though tonight, because it seemed honestly kind of wise, I do have a text, right? I'm not going to do this extemp. I do hope that we can spend some time thinking together and learning together through the process of oratory itself. Before I start, I do have some thank yous that I want the opportunity to express in addition to the kind introduction to Professor Hartnett. I want to really thank the students, the faculty, and the staff of the Communication Arts and Sciences Department at Penn State. You know, there are a number of truly wonderful graduate and communication programs across the nation right now, but you know, working at Penn State for me with that faculty is a true honor. And I just want to say to them in this moment, thank you. Thank you both for the past as well as for the present and for that department's future. I'm especially grateful to Adam Cody for his research assistant or assistance in preparing this particular project. Hi out there. I also want to thank Debbie Hawkey, Jeremy Ingalls, as well as Eric Watts for reading an earlier draft of this presentation. Any errors that you find in the draft, I probably added after they took a look at it. I want to thank my family, Janice, Nolan, and Cameron, for their love and support through not only this moment, but also throughout my entire career. Without them, in all honesty, none. None of this would be possible. I'm really humbled that my name will join such a distinguished list of Carroll Arnold speakers, especially because that list includes two of my career mentors, David Zarefsky and Carlin Kors Campbell. But ultimately, I want to admit to you tonight that I have a sneaking suspicion that my place on this platform says more about our moment in history and the pressing concerns of violence, of race, of politics, and of protest than it has anything to say about any accomplishment that I've had the opportunity to achieve thus far. So before I begin, please allow me one additional acknowledgement. I want you to know that my voice today is just part of a chorus. It's a chorus of communication scholars who think and write about communication and how communication can really help us achieve a more just society. Many members of this chorus are here this afternoon. So let me express my heartfelt appreciation to them. I have learned so much from your work, and I am really fortunate to count you as my friends. Thank you. In 1992, a political scientist from Queens College, his name was Andrew Hacker, published a book titled Two Nations, Black and White, Separate, Hostile, Unequal. The title came from one of the most important texts of the civil rights movement, the 1968 report of the National Advisory Commission on Civil Disorders. After successive summers of unrest, President Johnson had asked the Kerner Commission to discover why the nation's cities were suddenly exploding. And the answer came back as a stark warning. The commission reported, quote, "Our nation is moving towards two societies, one black, one white, separate and unequal." Now fast forward 24 years, and Andrew Hacker's empirical research suggested that this warning had in fact come true. White and black Americans did not enjoy the same civic privileges. He wrote, quote, "When white people hear the cry, 'The police are coming,' for them it almost always means that help is on the way. Black citizens cannot make the same assumption. If you are black and a young and a man, the arrival of the police does not usually signify help, but something very different." Now, Hacker concluded that the differences in experience and perception had led African Americans to respond to the nation's civic calling with quite a bit of reservation. He said, quote, "If you are black, you cannot easily join in the nation's refrain, in the anthem's refrain. You can't easily recite the pledge or affirm that your country is committed to equality. While you grant that the United States is your country, you may define your citizenship as partial and as qualified. And it's not that you are disloyal. Rather, you feel no compelling commitment to a republic that has always rebuffed you and your people." Now, I begin my lecture with Hacker's book for two specific reasons. First, Two Nation makes the traditional distinction between scholarship and civic action both useful but also inadequate. You see, Hacker viewed the need to redress social injustice as a kind of civic calling, but his response was part of his research and his teaching. You see, the distinction between scholarship and civic action, as well as its Derridean erasure, is relevant for our conference this week. As a discipline, we often explain communication research as a necessary part of understanding human relations, but the theme of this conference goes further. The theme of this conference suggests that we are called upon to speak to matters of social inequity, because knowledge creation is not enough. Now, I have no doubt that many here applaud this conference theme, but I also want to acknowledge that others are deeply suspicious. So as I begin, I want you to know that although my lecture will highlight what is at stake in the callings of civil society, I will not presume to tell you what your response should be. If you are fortunate enough to be listening to Audre Lorde tonight instead of me, I have no doubt she would say two things. First, after the election on Tuesday, silence will not keep you safe. You must speak. Second, I cannot do your moral reasoning for you. You must do it. Further, I want to recognize that there are, in fact, many different civic callings. Professor Tom Benson told me recently that Carroll Arnold was the faculty advisor for the Young Republicans Club at Cornell University in the 1950s. He took that responsibility very seriously. In fact, at one point, Professor Arnold threatened to resign as advisor if the club followed through with its plan to invite Senator Joe McCarthy to campus. Now again, after Tuesday, we might ask ourselves whether or not there is room for us to take a stand, perhaps in the streets, at least, I hope, on our college campuses. The second reason that I begin with Hacker's book is because it illustrates the topical concerns of my presentation. If we're going to hold a conference that investigates communication civic callings, then we first must understand the nature of the civil society to which we are called. The problems that Hacker explored in Two Nations have been a part of the African-American experience since the early Republic. They were the central theme of Frederick Douglass's famous 5th of July oration. Remember? Taking on the subject position of a slave, Douglass said, "I say it with a sad sense of the disparity between us. I am not included within the pale of this glorious anniversary. Your high independence only reveals the immeasurable distance between us. The blessings in which you this day rejoice are not enjoyed in common. The sunshine that brought life and healing to you has brought stripes and has brought death to me. The 4th of July is yours, not mine. You may rejoice. I must mourn. Today, I believe we are confronted with these same problems, but in a new guise. Weeks before the close of the first black presidency, and only a month after the National Museum of African American History and Culture opened its doors, the splash page of that museum's website proudly proclaims the following: a people's journey, a nation's story. Now, based on this webpage, it would seem that the story of black America is now the nation's narrative. But at the same time, we have also re-entered a period of civil unrest when people from Ferguson to Philadelphia declare that state-sanctioned violence against people of color is rampant. How and why does this incongruity exist? Building from my current work in collective memory and the civil rights movement, I propose that we spend some time thinking together about what our civil society is and how it calls to us as scholars and human beings. So, toward that end, I will examine two memories of the civil rights movement. The first memory is embedded in the rhetoric of President Barack Obama. In the coming moments, I intend to argue that Obama's collective memory of the civil rights movement gives rise to a nationalist vision of civil society that does build cohesion, that authorizes disruptive civil action, but that ultimately restricts that action to the interests of nationhood. The second example of memory that we'll explore is found in Ava DuVernay's film, Selma. If we are willing, I will argue, to consider a feminist revision of Obama's memory, then a different vision of civil society emerges that focuses on the integrity of lived experience and structural inequities before and prior to, and perhaps as a replacement for, our commitment to nationhood. So, to the talk proper. Since the early 1990s, US citizens have engaged in a widespread and accelerating process of memory creation about the civil rights movement. The communication through which we remember the movement takes multiple forms, including, but not limited to, monuments, museums, annual celebrations, poetry, fiction, revised textbooks, television specials, film, reenactment speeches, lots and lots and lots of speeches. Now, because of this memory work, a social movement that once divided the country has become an important part of the nation's symbolic and its material economies. Furthermore, our collective memory of the civil rights affects how we discuss our civic and social interests in the present. Let me give you a quick example. When the Supreme Court invalidated Section 4 of the 1965 Voting Rights Act, Chief Justice Roberts explained his decision through a particular configuration of memory. He praised the 1965 law, but then he remembered it as a legacy of a successful, and most importantly, a completed civil rights movement. Because the movement had achieved its goals, federal oversight of certain state elections was now unnecessary, even though, in the same opinion, Justice Roberts admitted that voting discrimination was still a problem in the United States. Crazy. Sorry. Now, in contrast, Justice Ginsburg's opinion offered a rival account of civil rights memory. Her memory argued that current discrimination proved that the civil rights movement was not yet complete. The Voting Rights Act was, therefore, still necessary and constitutional. Now, the conclusion that memory studies asks us to consider here is that Justice Ginsburg and Justice Roberts were not, in fact, separated by different historical methods. Instead, each opinion was participating in a different memory and therefore led to different obligations in the present. You see, memory is always partial. Memory is always incomplete. But memory is always consequential. It has real political and material effects. Now, several rhetoric scholars are interested in these effects. Carol Blair, Vanessa Gallagher, or Victoria Gallagher, Kristen Harold, Vanessa Beasley, Davis Hoke, David Tell, Sarah Jackson, and Kristen Parrott have published or are working currently on research that interprets the complexity and the contradictions of civil rights memory. I hope that you pursue their work. It's excellent work and worth reading. But today, I want to focus on just one function of civil rights memory: its ability to define the nature of civil society and its callings. And with respect to this function, President Barack Obama and the 1965 Voting Rights Campaign play a very special role. Recall that from January to March of 1965, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and the SCLC joined forces with SNCC and local activists to draw the nation's attention to the systematic violation of voting rights in Alabama. The three-month campaign would produce some of the most violent confrontations of the movement. Now, at the same time, that campaign became the impetus that President Johnson and Congress needed to pass the 1965 Voting Rights Act. As President Obama, he has in fact mentioned the Voting Rights Campaign on over 62 separate occasions. Now, sometimes when President Obama talks about Selma, he does so just in passing. But at other times, he actually constructs a very elaborate memory of Selma and the Voting Rights Campaign that I'm going to argue redefines civil society and how we, as citizens, are called upon to serve that civil society. On March the 7th of 2015, President Obama stood in front of the Edmund Pettus Bridge and addressed an audience who had gathered to commemorate a violent moment in U.S. history. You see, exactly 50 years before, black protesters had marched across the bridge to highlight the daily acts of intimidation and terror that had culminated in the murder of Jimmie Lee Jackson by Alabama State Trooper. Now, as protesters marched over the bridge, they were met by local and by state authorities. When they refused to disperse, officers on horseback and on foot began beating them. The media broadcast this confrontation nationally, and the day became known as Bloody Sunday. Now, Obama's speech introduces the events of March 7th as a kind of living memory, and he does so by focusing first on the figure of John Lewis. You see, Congressman Lewis had co-led the march in 1965, and he shared the stage with Barack Obama in 2015. The president begins his speech by narrating the sensations that Lewis and his colleagues must have felt that morning, noting that, quote, the air was thick with doubt, anticipation, and fear. And through this narration, Obama prompts the audience to feel what the protesters felt and see what the protesters saw. In fact, speaking in front of the bridge actually aids this collective remembrance, because the bridge itself acts as a kind of mnemonic device that collapses the audience's present into John Lewis's past. Now, Obama then moves from the personal and the local to the national. He compares Selma immediately to other sites of memory. He mentions Concord and Lexington, Independence Hall, Gettysburg, Appomattox. And then he says, Selma is a place where, quote, the nation's destiny was decided. He says, quote, in one afternoon 50 years ago, the stain of slavery and the anguish of civil war, the yoke of segregation and the tyranny of Jim Crow, the death of four little girls in Birmingham, and the dream of a Baptist preacher, all of that history met on this bridge. It was not a clash of armies, but a clash of wills, a contest to determine the true meaning of America. Now, here in the early moments of his address, we see how the memory that President Obama is crafting is about more than just local commemoration. It is, in fact, a particular construction of nationhood. The racial progress that Obama so often lauds in his speeches results from a shift in which African and European Americans have become collaborators in civil society. This association, for which Obama's amazing success is a kind of immediate or embodied proof, is also at the heart of his civil rights memory. So, for example, in reference to how people responded after the violence of Bloody Sunday was broadcast nationally, right? Well, in fact, internationally, Obama states the following, quote, "White and black, young and old, Christian and Jew, waving the American flag, singing the same anthems, full of faith and hope, they all came." And why did they come? Why did they come to Selma? The president answers, quote, "Because they shared something, a faith in God, a faith in America, but most importantly, a faith in the idea that America is not yet complete." This argument, more than any other, structures Obama's vision of nationhood and civil society. He defines the nation not as a geographic space or as a unique constitutional government, but as an experiment in freedom that requires the participation of all of its citizens. He explains, quote, "What greater form of patriotism is there than the belief that America is not yet finished, that each successive generation can look upon our imperfections and decide that it is in our power to remake this nation to more closely align with its highest ideals. That's why Selma is not a museum or a static monument to behold from a distance. It is instead the manifestation of a creed written into our founding documents. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal." Now, according to the president, the memory of Selma reveals the ideology and the civic action of civil society. American citizenship is bound to the Declaration of Independence and a belief in the idea, he says, quote, "that America is a constant work in progress, that loving this country requires more than singing its praises or avoiding uncomfortable truths. It requires the occasional disruption, the willingness to speak out for what's right, to shake up the status quo. That's America. That's what makes us unique." Now, before I continue, I want to draw your attention to three important consequences of Obama's memory. First, it makes room for a civic calling that includes the occasional disruption and social protest. You see, the agitator becomes a patriot who reminds us that the country is never finished. And in addition, she identifies which imperfections society must address next. Second, Obama's memory sutures civil society so closely to nationhood that it's difficult to see where one begins and the other ends. Indeed, the agitator is important precisely because of what she reveals about the truth and vitality of our country. Now, this, I want to argue for you, is an important innovation. Through the power of his office, Obama injects the Black Jeremiadic tradition directly into our mythic narrative of America's divine mission to the world. Now, presumably, it would seem, anyone can perform the rhetorical patterns of the Black Jeremiad because their foundation is no longer sutured to blackness, but instead a belief in America's founding documents and a faith that society can change. But third, even as Obama's memory makes agitation an essential part of nationhood, it also constrains the proper methods and ends of that protest. Social protest should look like the civil rights movement of Obama's memory. It should be interracial. It should engage in nonviolent action that is disruptive, but not too threatening. It should reject cynicism and despair in favor of a democratic faith in the myth of American exceptionalism and its capacity for change. And finally, it should end in traditional politics. It should end in law. The president explained, quote, "There's nothing America can't handle if we actually look squarely at the problem. And this is work for all Americans, not just some. If we want to honor the courage of those who marched that day, then all of us are called to possess their moral imagination. All of us will need to feel, as they did, the fierce urgency of now. All of us need to recognize, as they did, that change depends on our actions, on our attitudes, on the things that we teach our children. And if we make such an effort, no matter how hard it may sometimes seem, laws can be passed and consciences can be stirred and consensus can be built. Folks, these are stirring words. They express a faith and an inspiration that I desperately want to believe in. But belief and hope and faith, they're not enough. Quite frankly, they've never been enough. Obama is right to say that change depends upon action. But before we march forward, we need to interrogate the action to which we are being called. Two events of this past spring provide that specific opportunity. In April of this year, President Obama spoke to a young audience in London, and he offered this assessment of the current protests in America. He said, quote, "I think that what, for example, Black Lives Matter is doing now to bring attention to the problem of the criminal justice system that sometimes is not treating people fairly has been really effective. But once you've highlighted an issue and elected officials are ready to sit down with you, then you can't just keep yelling at them. The value of social movements and activism is to get you at the table, to get you in the room," end quote. Now in May, the president told the graduating class at Howard University something very similar. He said, quote, "Democracy requires compromise, even when you are 100% right. We remember Dr. King's soaring oratory, the power of his letter from Birmingham jail, the marches he led, but he also sat down with President Johnson in the Oval Office and to get a Civil Rights Act and a Voting Rights Act passed. And those two seminal bills were not perfect, but they made things better," end quote. Thus, did you hear it? Did you hear it? To Obama's stirring rendition of the Black Jeremiad, he adds the political advice of Henry Clay. Oh, I'm ashamed to admit it. I've never been a big fan of Henry Clay. For communication scholars who want to engage in civic action beyond the classroom, Obama's civil rights memory points the way. It begins with an inspired message and media attention, and then transitions into the pragmatic politics of incremental change. Choose your leaders, construct your demands, grab the nation's attention, get to the table, and work towards a compromise that makes things a little bit better. These folks are the tried and true modes of Republican government. But let me ask you a question. Is our civil society healthy enough to make this process actually successful? Now, I'm not asking you this question because of the results of Tuesday's election. It's too easy for Democrats and for Republicans to either wallow in despair or exultation according to the latest election. What I'm asking is this: do the past 8 years, or 12 years, or 20 years give you confidence that the aim of protests should always be to get inside, to get a seat at the table of power? Now, if you asked individuals from the Black Lives Matter movement, spokespeople like Netta Elzey, DeRay Maxson, or Kianga Yamada Taylor, they would probably respond with an emphatic no. Black Lives Matter, those protesters, do not see the civil rights movement as an unqualified success. and they have rebuffed the assistance of former civil rights leaders. This, along with the fact that the face of Black Lives Matter movement is largely queer and female, has led media pundits to the conclusion that today's protesters have actually rejected the movement. This assessment is wrong. Black Lives Matter has rejected modes of organization and action that constitute our limited memory of the civil rights movement. In addition, they resist the kind of civic calling that most of our political leaders draw from that memory. Contemporary protesters are not motivated by a faith in American exceptionalism or the country's capacity for change. They acknowledge that the whiteness that once overdetermined civil society may have fractured a little. Maybe. I had that line in there before Tuesday. But they point to anti-black violence as evidence of racism's continued power. To understand contemporary protesters, we need to consider what Orlando Patterson and Saja Hartman identify as the social death that accompanies slavery. Critical theorists of race have offered a controversial reinterpretation of the condition that we call slavery. They argue that slavery's most important features were never, in fact, its legal or its economic structures. The core elements of slavery were instead, first, the dehumanization of people of color. Second, a regime of terror, violence, and intimidation in which the slave is unable to protect his or her own body. And C, the control of all social, civic, and even temporal relations between the slave and others. Now, defined in this way, current theorists contend that slavery is not, in fact, confined to the past. These conditions can and may, in fact, be present today. They continue. The term social death is conceptualized from this position. It is part of the transformation of a human being into objects, objects that have no identity and therefore no social relationships apart from the social relationships that slavery creates for them. You see, the slave can be a friend or an enemy. The slave can be a lover or a beast. The slave can be an economic partner or property. The slave can even be President of the United States or a Muslim charlatan born in Africa. These contradictions of representation and their corresponding relationships do not in fact matter because the slave has no inherent being. The slave is only what slavery needs it to be in any given moment for its own interests. Now, it's difficult, I think, for us to consider slavery in this mode. But I want you for a moment to consider the thoughts of someone who was intimately acquainted with slavery. When the Civil War and the 13th Amendment prompted many abolitionists to conclude that their societies were no longer needed, Frederick Douglass warned that slavery might not be dead. He said, quote, "They would not call it slavery, but some other name. Slavery has been fruitful in giving itself many names, and it will call itself by yet another name, and you and I and all of us had better wait and see what new form this old monster will assume, in what new skin the snake will come forth next." Now, contemporary protesters believe that in 2016, the snake of slavery is still evident in our prison systems and in urban communities from Ferguson to Philadelphia. You see, slavery reemerges in the present when the unique experiences that comprise blackness are erased by a society that requires their abrogation in return for civic participation. Social death transpires when the particular interests of black lives are subsumed by the general interests of the nation. This is why protesters resist Obama's call to compromise, because at the negotiation table, these same protesters will be forced to discuss the conditions under which the death of a young black man is an unfortunate accident and not a crime. Was Michael Brown a criminal? Was Trayvon Martin a mortal threat? Did Keith Lamont Scott have a gun in his hand? Now, folks, these are all reasonable questions in a society that is governed by traditional principles of individual justice. Nevertheless, they are also the very questions that allow society to ignore the degree to which a certain type of blackness is sutured to criminality, even before any individual act has transpired. A hoodie. It's all it takes. Now, to be clear, Obama supports the message that black lives matter. Nevertheless, the civil society of his civil rights memory leads to a moment when black being must enter into a contract with national being. Charles Mills would surely remind us that this might have been fine for Hobbes, but the contract is a trap for Black Lives Matter. Please don't miss this argument. It's an important challenge to Obama's otherwise remarkable vision of civil society. The incremental politics of making things better, generation after generation after generation, will falter under the conditions of slavery. Slavery, like a snake, will simply evolve around those incremental changes. It will offer fame and fortune to a biracial young man who grew up with a single white mother in a trailer park. Talking about me. While slavery transforms another person with a similar background and equal intelligence into a prison system where involuntary servitude is still constitutional. We are faced then with an important question. Are there ways to remember the civil rights movement that address some of the concerns that I've noted here? Can we build useful memories that create a civil society with alternative civic callings? I believe the answer is yes. Director Ava DuVernay is a vocal proponent of the idea that cultural production and entertainment can, in fact, fulfill a civic calling. We can see that principle in a lot of her documentary work, like the recent film 13th, as well as her fictional work. Now, here, I would like to consider three lessons from her 2014 Oscar-nominated film, Selma. These are lessons, I will argue, that arise from a configuration of memory that focuses on the experiences of black women within the film, and they serve as either a counterpart or perhaps even an alternative to Obama's memory. And I'll let you decide which. Lesson number one. A feminist memory of the civil rights movement highlights the intersectional nature of oppression. Now, most memories of the civil rights movement tend to focus on singular aspects of the movement. The March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom becomes King's I Have a Dream speech. The racial and gendered tensions in working class Montgomery, Alabama becomes Rosa Parks' refusal to give up her bus seat, right? The Selma campaign becomes either the violence of Bloody Sunday or the victorious marching of white and black protesters. Now, for reasons that are perfectly understandable, but nonetheless very limiting, the deep and complex texture of the civil rights movement is usually flattened. The movie Selma fights that urge. In one of its early scenes, we watch as Annie Lee Cooper, played by Oprah Winfrey, tries to register to vote. In the scene's opening moments, the white registrar calls her name. Annie Lee Cooper, get on up. I haven't got all day. Now, with this call, the registrar interpolates Cooper into a specific relationship with himself. She is the supplicant, and he is the ruler. It is his time that counts. It's his time that matters. And he is immediately to business. but the business he pursues is not necessarily civic. With the line, quote, "You work for Mr. Dunn, down at the rest home, ain't that right?" Duvernay's film illustrates how voting rights and economic opportunity are intertwined. But then, immediately, to the issues of class and race, the film adds patriarchy. The registrar says, "I wonder what old Dunn will say when I tell him one of his gals is down here stirring a fuss." One of Dunn's gals, Annie Lee Cooper, belongs to Mr. Dunn. She doesn't belong there in a courthouse. She belongs back at work with all the other gals, taking care of the elderly who are probably white. Now the threat here is clear. If Annie Lee Cooper persists, she might not even have a job to return to. Duvernay's film puts the intersectional politics of gender, class, and race into conversation, but to this three-part mix, he adds the structural and the personal dynamics of oppression. The registrar is an individual, and he is the state. When Cooper hands over the paperwork, she says, "It's right this time," and he responds, "It's right when I say it's right." It is his opinion that matters. He is both the conduit to civic participation and the gatekeeper who determines who may enter. After Cooper successfully overcomes the first two tests that he devises, the registrar asks her to name all 67 Alabama County judges. Now, in that command, he has thrown down an obstacle that Cooper cannot overcome. But in fact, she never could have overcome the obstacles to her registration because the interlocking systems of oppression can always invent more. Furthermore, the simultaneously personal and structural nature of Cooper's experience results in a situation where the responsibility for the fact that Cooper can't vote is always deferred. You see, the state can say it's not to blame. It's just the prejudice of the registrar. And the registrar can say he's not to blame. He is just following the law. And in this moment, when no one has responsibility, it's only Cooper herself who is to blame for the fact that she cannot vote. The second lesson of a feminist memory of the civil rights movement problematizes the boundary between public and private. Our collective civil rights memory is typically a memory of brave deeds done in public spaces. But in fact, a lot of the work of the civil rights movement was performed in private. Most certainly, the consequences of protests were always borne out away from the public eye. Duvernay explores this theme through scenes of affection and estrangement between Coretta Scott King and Martin Luther King. Consider this scene, where Coretta confronts Martin about his infidelities after the FBI has sent a sex tape to their house. The scene that Duvernay constructs here is, of course, part speculation and part fiction. Like most private scenes, there is no record, and those who were there have said little about it. But despite these concerns, what I believe that the director gets right here is her portrayal of the private toll that oppression and activism take on relationships and on families. Coretta tells Martin that because of his work, their family has no foundation. Their children do not have the things that they need, all because of how it would look. She has gotten used to this, for better or for worse, but she says, "What I have never gotten used to is the death, the constant closeness of death." That, I think, is the key line in this scene. You see, death is not just a public experience. Death is felt in intimate, private spaces where parents, partners, and children are denied their loved ones. It created, in Coretta's words, a fog that kept a person from seeing life. What was true of death was also true of other dimensions of the civil rights movement. The public and the private cannot be easily separated. And when we fail to recognize their connection, we end up missing the very people and problems that most need our attention. The third lesson, and our final lesson, of a feminist memory of the civil rights... Oop. Sorry about that. I'm just going to let this play. Now, for weeks, I've really debated about whether I would use this clip. I struggle with the question of whether playing it just reinscribes anti-black racism. Yet, there are times when our civic calling is simply to bear witness. In this scene, the metaphorical fog of death that Coretta described to Martin has become material. The bridge is shrouded with tear gas that symbolizes death's likely presence. Now, of particular interest to me is how the scene reaches back in time to images of slavery. Especially, I would argue, in the slow shots of white men on horseback chasing down the protesters. I am reminded of slaves running through the fog, pursued by slave hunters. Your gender, your age, the speed of your legs, they don't matter. The threat of death surrounds you, and violence comes out of the mist. The whip that lays down the law is there, and the distance between slavery and 1965 and today are collapsed in the memories of black audiences who have all dreamed this nightmare before. This is a race that they're not likely to win. Now, let's not flinch from this memory. DuVernay's reenactment of Bloody Sunday prompts us to remember the vulnerable body and our own collusion in its harm. We tend to remember the violence of the civil rights movement through the language of redemptive suffering or heroic sacrifice. This allows us to acknowledge that violence was a fact, but then distance ourselves from its implication. But here there is nothing heroic in the images that DuVernay presents to us. The march of black citizens for justice is turned, at least for a moment, into black bodies lying on the ground, unconscious and bruised and bleeding. We are called upon to witness this scene and to consider whether and how we are responsible for what has happened. Their vulnerability is also our vulnerability, and the systems that made such violence happen are still active today. Now, of course, history did not end on Bloody Sunday. The film does move on, and the images of suffering are replaced with black and white marchers moving forward together into the future. The end of this movie really coincides well with the memory of Selma that President Obama provided for us earlier. But I want to warn you away from the conclusion that this scene is either redemptive or primarily about the nation. You see, their marching did not ease the physical or emotional wounds of Bloody Sunday. It did not change the minds and the hearts of the white men and women who lined the road on their way to Montgomery, called them nigger, and spit on them along the way. Instead, the protesters marched to honor the dead and the dying. They marched out of love for themselves and their community. Many, but not all, marched because of a faith in God. But ultimately, these people marched because the only life-affirming response to death and slavery is resistance. Resistance by any means necessary. You see, if we're really going to say that the civil rights movement is part of the American story, then we have an obligation. We have an obligation to its call. That call begins with a request that we all stand up and we declare, my life matters. I have something to say, and I have a responsibility to say it. The civil rights movement then advances a second call, which insists that we look at people whose interests and experiences and needs are not the same as our own, and we say to them, your life matters. Please tell me about it. I will listen even if I don't understand. And I will support the effort to see your life fulfilled. The civil rights movement calls to us a third time. And this time it asks us to remember that structure itself matters. That life is lived in and among material systems. Therefore, we have to produce scholarship that considers whether or not the existing structures are actually sufficient to meet the needs of the very people that they're supposed to serve. Finally, the civil rights movement calls to us a final time. And it says, Black life matters. Not in some abstract expression about a community that we avoid on our way to work, but in the radical specificity of a living human being. We need to listen to this call. We need to listen to this call not for the sake of the nation, not for a mythic narrative that began with the Declaration of Independence. Black life matters not because we are marching toward a more perfect union. Black life matters because people are dead, and they didn't have to die. Black life matters because more are going to die tomorrow. Now, saying this does not magically absolve all of the problems that make us two nations, hostile and unequal. Hard work, protest work, negotiation work is necessary. But maybe if we take this idea seriously, it could be enough for us to start again. You see, so much of the civil rights movement comes down to one very simple claim. Life matters. It matters in all of its specificity, in all of its faults, and in all of its contradiction. Life matters. And so does death. What more important calling for communication is there?